Hello and welcome to the second part of our toolbox lecture on future punk. I mean, the idea of the whole course, future punk, is to provide kind of all these tools that people in the past have developed to think about the future in a business way, in a military way, but also in a creative way, and take them apart and reshuffle them to come up with your own ideas. This is the punk thing of it. And I mean, of course, nothing is more suited for that than the tools that are used in capitalism, in military, and in all the things that think of the future as being to be shaped in a technocratic way. So today we will particularly look at scenario planning, a bit into how startups work, and then finally into speculative design. So, one of my favorite quotes, William Gibson, in an interview with James Gleick. James Gleick is a very interesting person. He wrote many very interesting books on information, on technology. And Gibson and Gleick have this conversation in the New York Public Library. William Gibson, I've mentioned, is basically the first mainstream author of the cyberpunk movement with his book Neuromancer, that became a major bestseller and is still widely read today. Neuromancer, where he coins the term cyberspace for what we think of as being the internet. So, and Gibson is laying out kind of a mixed pessimistic or realistic future of collapses and then kind of rebuilding the world over the next 150 or so years. And then he says this one sentence: "There is no future, it's only risk management." And that should remind you of your reading of Nassim Taleb, because that's exactly what Taleb argues for from the economic perspective or more philosophical perspective. So don't think of the future as something that can be magically predicted, but of something that that bears risks, and think of what these risks might be. Risks are, of course, thinking now in business jargon, always also opportunities. You know, you can always exploit catastrophes for your own benefit. I mean, you listen to me, I have some evilness in my voices here. There is, of course, all kinds of fun that you can make of these business things, because many of them, although initially intellectually really sound, I would say, have been degraded and boiled down to kind of this very flat level of ridiculousness. I mean, I have my share in that as well, as being a consultant, and realizing that people that you consult with in companies or the government are usually not that interested in what you have to tell to them, and so you better make fun of things and make it kind of entertaining. And so, and these tools that we will discuss today can be very entertaining, and can be really great on on coming up with creative stories. A lot in kind of dystopian future, we will talk about dystopias a bit later, has to do with the end of growth. I mean, the last lecture was all about growth. Everything grows exponentially, in particular the number of people on the earth. Although usually the curve flattens, I mean, growth never goes infinitely, at least not on Earth. Many people think that people will just continue to propagate, although there is no indication that that will actually happen. And Thomas Malthus, a thinker in England about 250 years ago, so in the time before the start really of the Industrial Revolution in England, at the time when people started to move to the city and a lot of the countryside in England was turned from crop farming that would actually nourish people to pastures where sheep would basically be held, because the landowners turned from feudal lords that would actually have some obligation to care for their people into capitalist landowners, into rent seekers, and would earn much more money from the wool and the textile that they could produce from their land than from the crops that people would just eat. And so this is the kind of in a nutshell what happened in England when Malthus lived, and Malthus saw all the people starving, and you know the story that England, I mean, it was a very cruel regime at that time. I mean, they invented basically the slave trade, or co-invented it, and subjected half of the world to their colonial imperialist rule, exploiting everyone amongst the first, of course, their own people. And there were suddenly too many people to feed, and then they shipped them overseas, first to what then later becomes the United States, and then also to Australia. So people were forcefully put on ships. Many people died and would just be pushed out of the country, in particular in Ireland, which was occupied by England at that time. So this is Malthus seeing all this misery, and he says that is horrible. People will just, I mean, population will grow and grow and grow, and the yield will not. So people will start starving, and everything will be really horrible. And that's called the Malthusian future. And Malthusian future is particularly characterized by the lack of risk management. So people see that that happens, but they don't do anything. And there's a lot of discussion about climate change that works the same way. That people say, oh God, everything will change and we will have huge amounts of refugees, but instead of doing something about it, for example, thinking of how to help people in time when it is still cheap, waiting until nothing really can be done except shipping people to other places. So, yeah, that's a bit kind of the political scenario behind these things. Yeah, the world scenario has fallen, so scenario planning is the first tool that we would briefly look into. Scenario planning comes from the war, in particular from Second World War. In the Second World War, some leading mathematicians that had fled from Europe to the United States, in particular John von Neumann, used what they had just developed in the 1930s in terms of probability theory and thinking about games into strategy planning. So John von Neumann wrote this seminal paper about card games, where he sat down and think, how likely is it with a certain hand to win a card game? And then he thought, let's calculate the same for chess, father games, and then in particular then in the 1940s, helping the US military to win the Second World War, he would develop ideas how to use this kind of game theory thinking for military strategy planning. And that is believed to have helped a lot, in particular in the Pacific War against against Japan. So this is the kind of the background of scenario planning. And after the Second World War, it was immediately taken over, kind of repurposed by big corporations, in particular corporations that had some kind of geopolitical implication, like oil. So the Shell Corporation, so Shell, Royal Dutch Shell, is a multinational conglomerate that is basically sitting in the Netherlands. They are, they were, I think, leading the crowd in using scenarios to come up with what could happen, and planning their oil drilling efforts and whatever with that. So let's see a bit into scenario planning. First thing that we always start with is we have to make assumptions. So we think about the future, maybe like 5 years, 10 years, 100 years in the future, and say, what is it actually that is different? I mean, what are the drivers for change? For example, oil gets scarce, or there will be more oil, but climate change hits, or renewable energy, in particular wind and photovoltaic, get very cheap, and so no one will buy the oil anymore, and so on. So you think of what happens on the big scale, and then you think, okay, what comes out of that? But you could also think of just next year and think of, yeah, what is if the pandemic really spoiled people's interest into fashion? So, what fashion do people wear at home? That is a typical scenario that maybe a fashion retailer would have. And say, maybe I invest more in pajamas and bathrobes than in evening gowns or something like that. I mean, I'm not joking. That's exactly what's happening. I've read quite a bit about that like half a year ago when the fashion industry also fell in the great despair due to the pandemic. So that's the assumptions. The assumptions don't help much if we don't have a framework to make sense of them. So the framework is usually a spreadsheet or could be a blackboard where you write things down and then think of how they are interconnected. In particular, there is things like, for example, the oil price. So over a long time, there was a scenario that everyone believed in that was called peak oil. And peak oil meant that at one point, the oil demand, which rises, 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 would exceed what could be discovered in terms of new oil wells. And that would lead to an explosion in oil price. So the oil price would be completely inflated, and the barrel of oil would be like thousands of dollars instead of like tens of dollars as it is now. And so this peak oil scenario, and people were, oh, that will be really difficult. Let's look what happened during the oil crisis in the 1970s when the Gulf states started the Organization of Petrol Exporting Countries, OPEC, to finally get the money that they actually was due to them. I mean, from the side of the West, that was of course very painful. But actually, I mean, what right do countries like the countries in Europe or the United States have to exploit the oil resources of the Gulf without paying due price for it? I mean, you really have to ask that. So I think the foundation of the OPEC was one of the first really powerful steps in post-colonialism after the Indian Revolution, I would say, which was really also a very strong post-colonial step. And after that happened, I mean, people in 1973, people were in total panic. I remember that as a child, it was really one of my first memories that I actually can point down was my father pushing me in a stroller on the Autobahn because cars were not allowed to drive every other day to save the oil resources. So and then when peak oil, when the idea of peak oil came in the 1980s, people said, well, let's look back to the 1970s and think what happened then. I mean, what was the dependencies? Which industries were hit first? Where did people react and so on? And this is a scenario. You build a spreadsheet with dependencies. You say, well, this is what happens and this is what follows. And then it's a chain of things that are connected with each other. So that's your framework. The third is then you brainstorm. I mean, you should scenario planning is more fun to do with other people, but you could do that on your own, of course. It's like playing chess with yourself. Not much fun, but you can do that definitely. You can just think of, I don't know how people, I can't do that, but I mean, many people do. So you come up with as many scenarios as you could. You just think all the kinds of things that might happen. And one thing with peak oil, to just stick with this scenario, is, I mean, now we see that it was just blatantly wrong. I mean, it just didn't assume that people might find alternative sources of energy first, and second, that the energy consumption would not just exponentially grow forever, but would flatten, as this is always the case. Because, you know, you can only use up so much energy in the end. I mean, when everyone has a car, I mean, you can't drive in two cars at the same time, and the car engines got so much more efficient. So this Malthusian scenario of peak oil, the typical Malthus, things will grow until they fail, didn't happen with oil, as we see. The oil price is very stable and is even dropping. So better come up with alternative scenarios, as many as you can. I mean, really weird ones. I mean, there is one book in the reading, the Cyclonopedia by the Iranian author Reza Negastani. So this book is a very, I would say, weird science fiction on on a theory that's that says that the petrel actually is a geological origin, of geological origin. It's not fossil, so it's not from tiny organisms that died a trillion years, a trillion years ago or whatever, a billion years ago. So sorry, but it's actually a part of the Earth's original geology, and so there is probably an almost infinite amount of it. Although this is not very likely, it is discussed by geologists, I mean, in all earnesty. I mean, because I mean, it seems that the oil wells never dry out. I mean, there's always more that comes from the ground. So, thinking of that, I mean, just come up with many, many scenarios what might happen, and don't judge. In a brainstorming, you don't judge. You just write them down, no matter how crazy they are. And in the next, you just condense them. I mean, many of the scenarios will basically be very similar. I mean, they will be different in details, and then you choose the most compelling ones and reduce things to like a few scenarios that you can actually handle in your mind, which is usually something like 3 to 6. I mean, the rule of thumb is always that more than 6 is always difficult, maybe 7, because then you lose track. It's a bit like how many people can comfortably have a conversation around the table. The old school etiquette says 6, and so that's always good to remember. Or how many bullet points do you have on a slide? Well, 6 or 7 or something like that. Yeah, and then you have to tell the story of the scenario. You have to make it plausible. You have to come up with a narrative that makes it tangible. I mean, if you just say, well, the oil will be very expensive, and then I don't know what happens then, and then no one will believe you first, and it is very hard to actually grasp the consequences. So be very visual with it. Come up with illustrations. The best, of course, is really visual. Kind of visualizations or models or whatever. And then for each scenario, each, don't kind of trick yourself out here. For each scenario, you painfully precisely describe what issues rise. So, what is the consequence if that happens, even if it is kind of a weird scenario? And now comes a really important imperative by one of the leading scenario people, that is Peter Schwartz. So Peter Schwartz, very famous consultant. I think he works for Salesforce as their chief strategy officer, and he says, never put quantities behind the scenarios. Never say this scenario has a likelihood of happening like that. Because then your manager or whoever makes the decisions looks at that and says, oh, that's very unlikely. Let's just keep it out. And that's exactly what you are not supposed to do. Because you should think, well, this is unlikely, but when it happens, it might really be very bad for me. Or I have really to reconsider what I'm doing. So that is the very brief brushing through through scenario planning. We will come back in particular to the storytelling when we discuss design thinking and other storytelling tools in the speculative design part. I mean, thinking of scenarios, I mentioned that the pandemic certainly can't be called a black swan because everyone knew that it would happen at some point. But nevertheless, I mean, the impact is really interesting to look at. If you look here at the employment, so how many people are employed in the United States? And I think it's a pretty good indicator in other countries as well. I mean, countries that have a bit more stable labor laws, it's not so much unemployment, it's furlough. Or in the UAE, people got sent home that were no longer needed, which results in the same thing, that they are unemployed basically. So if you see the impact of the pandemic on the labor market, I mean, you see how grave it is actually. I mean, look at the previous economic crisis. I mentioned the oil crisis in the 1970s. You see that it's a dip. Then in the 1980s there was a recession and financial crisis. And then in the 1990s again, and then in the 2000s, that was the dot-com crisis, and then things got better. And you see, they are always kind of the same. I mean, they're not really, even if you think in the moment it's the worst crisis that you ever had, but they're of the same dimension. And then comes, of course, the financial crisis in 2006, 7, 8, and following. And you see that that was much worse. And I believe that it is much worse in most countries. I mean, if you look in the European Union, for example, countries like Greece, Portugal, Spain, and Italy basically went bankrupt and haven't recovered from that time. Portugal, I think, has done the best job in recovery, and some parts of Spain are also no longer doing that badly. But Greece and most parts of Italy are still really a mess economically, and mass unemployment in particular in Greece, and political radicalization. So this is something that happened 10 years ago, or more than 10 years ago. And what we see now has just started, and of course we don't see the long-term implications of that, but you see, I mean, how much worse it is than it ever was. Yeah, just kind of starting your imagination on future scenarios here. The interesting thing here, I mean, I take these slides from Benedict Evans, and I mentioned that Benedict Evans in these startup analytics also is always a good point to start. His Twitter feed or his blog posts are really interesting in that, although often I think he's not, I don't agree, but his data is always good. Because he's an analyst and he's very diligent. So this is also really interesting. I mean, if you look at these companies that basically have not so long ago been founded, they're all startups, and you see at the valuation, that means how much is the company worth, and you see how many companies like have been started in the last 15 or so years that are really, really expensive tech companies. And one can be added here now, which is Clubhouse, that just received a valuation of $1.1 or so billion. So you see that there is a continuous supply of new, really valuable startups. That is so the complementary also to the early stage investment that startups receive, which in all places seems to rise in a very consistent way. What is very nice to see is, I mean, we only have Europe here on the slide, but it diversifies. So it's not that the startup scene in the US, in particular on the West Coast, has become any weaker. Capital is flowing into the startup scene in California as it always did. However, the investment into startups has started in other places too. It's not only Europe, it's of course a lot China, although the numbers are not as transparent in China, but it's incredible how many startups in China would be in this club of these multi-billion dollar startups now. And in Singapore, and more also in other places, like for example, I just read an interesting article about startup financing in Lagos, for example. So a nice thing is that the idea of starting a valuable company spreads into places. I mean, like Germany was never very entrepreneurial. It was very hard always to start a company, but that changes now. So, I mean, despite this ominous clouds of the pandemic crisis and economic downswing, it's worthwhile looking into startup financing if you come up with your own startup idea. You should have a business model behind that. So financing is not how your startup makes money. I mean, that is really important to keep in mind. That is a totally different question. So so one way is bootstrapping. You take your own money or the money of your family and friends, and this is how you start and survive for how long it takes. I mean, like a year, 5 years, or whatever it takes to develop your startup's products. I mean, this makes sense to do. I mean, you have maybe several founders. Don't start a startup on your own. I can not recommend that. It's always better to have a group of people doing that together, like 2 to 5 or so. If you have done something before, I mean, like if you have money on the side from a previous startup, for example, that's of course much easier. So it is of course a bias towards privilege. Privileged people have it much easier to found startups. And that is, of course, why like 95% of all startup founders in the US are white men. Slowly, that starts to change. Then there is angel investment, which is very similar. So business angels are people who have money and entrepreneurial spirit and look for companies in which they could give like maybe $100,000 to maybe $1 million. So depending of course of what you make, if it is hardware or biotech or so, it might be a bit more that you need to start a company. But if it is software, you probably just need to pay your people for maybe a year or two. So this is the business angel. Business angels also bring, hopefully at least, connections that they have, business connections to other people, and can help the startup founder to get the first real round, which would be venture capital. And it's called venture capital for a reason, because it is high risk. So in Silicon Valley, the statistics I think is about as follows: from 100 startups that you fund, about 10 make it, and only one really pays you back. So don't be don't make the mistake to think just because a startup makes decent money makes the investors happy. Because I mean, if you think of a company just making money, that means they pay their wages and the founders, I mean, get maybe decent wage. But an investor who has 100 startups to invest in and only 10 who are reasonable, they need of course a payback that's much better. And this is this one startup out of 100 that actually receives a global footprint that actually is really valuable. So this is why it's called venture capital. So the return on investment for venture capital is something below between 5% and 10%. So it is in a way the same as if you finance insurances or so. So don't think of it as a method of becoming a billionaire. That is usually not the case. Some people might, I mean, they might be very lucky, but usually an investment fund is just like any other investment fund, venture capital fund is just like any other investment fund, making its money in a very tedious way, and it's a lot of work, and the payback is at the same interest rate as for other investments. So that's venture capital. It's a very interesting scene. I mean, it's interesting people. It's a lot of people who had started own startups. It's people who are very interested in data, into analysis, and people who are interested in people. Because, of course, in the beginning, I mean, nothing is more important than getting the right people together. And if you found the if you start a company, you might know a couple of people to do that with you, but then, I mean, how would you know more people? I mean, if you are not, I mean, that might just not be your skill. And so one of the most important things that angel investors and venture capitalists bring to the table is having a big network of potential employees for any kind of startup. Venture capital funds are usually concentrated on a certain type of business. Although they diversify, there is usually certain businesses on which they can concentrate. I mean, if you think of how much work it is to to keep a business running and keep the accounting straight and help the help your management team of your startup. It is really very limited how many portfolio companies you can hold. So this is why venture capital has people the people working there dealing with their portfolio investments with their portfolio companies can only deal with a limited number of kind of loose ends, so to say, and they're usually highly concentrated on certain industries. And a second thing that I just forgot. Maybe it comes back later. So that is venture capital. So that makes it an interesting scene, I would say. Then after venture capital comes the seed. So the seed with venture capital is usually bringing in people who have enough money to give you like a decent start for maybe 2 or 3 years. And growth is the phase where you get a lot more money. So if you made it through the seed phase, at the end of the seed phase, your company might just be very nicely profitable, but might not have the potential to grow. So you might have a very specialized technology company that does quite well, but actually the market is not that big. And then the venture capitalists would be very disappointed, but they would say, well, that was great meeting you. Wish you good luck and hopefully your company does well in the future. So, but sometimes you see that there is a trajectory for growth, that the company has the potential to reach a lot of other clients that they don't have yet. That means that you need to hire salespeople, that you need to hire salespeople who do business to business, for example. I mean, for example, if you expand to markets in other countries, you need to have people who know these other countries. And you can't just go somewhere and say, well, now we do business here. As you know, most countries are very restrictive in that. So you need local people, you need people who have an understanding of sales culture. And these are usually not startup people. These are people who come from enterprises, who maybe are technology salespeople. And this is in this phase, you always see kind of these senior Intel people or senior Microsoft people entering in a startup. Like you see this, the new director of sales of this startup comes from Microsoft and had done, I don't know, Microsoft Office Enterprise sales or whatever. So it's the growth phase, and in the growth phase, a different kind of venture capitalists join you. Might even be other investors. It's a totally different kind of funds that join you here, and your shares are watered down now. I mean, you have to increase the capital, and your share price drops, so to say, per share. Because I mean. You have enough shares to give that to the other investors. And then finally comes the exit. I mean, hopefully, this is when the founders leave the company. The company goes maybe public, or the company gets acquired by another company. And that is the so-called liquidity event. This is when everyone gets paid. There's of course many companies where the founders just stay. I mean, think of Amazon with Jeff Bezos or Facebook with Mark Zuckerberg. I mean, these are the founders of the company and they're still there. So it is not necessarily the case that the founders leave, but it is often the case because you need different type of management to have a company that really runs on scale. This is kind of the people who know administration, who know taxes and accounting, who know controlling and all these tools that you know for need for big corporations. So as a brief overview on startup funding, and if you come up with your own slide deck, just think of how the money could be used for your company. Just a nice example that I stumbled upon in the Y Combinator Hacker News. This is a great source, by the way. The Y Combinator Hacker News can only recommend to look at it. Let's try to make the. I'll put it into the syllabus, the link. How to start a biotech company from almost no money. And that's a nice success story. that you could think of using for your own stories. So, how do you actually envision a product? So, we now move from these businessy things more into the shiny things. I mean, how to come up with a product. And I would say in the last 30 years, this process of design thinking has become kind of the magic wand that everyone uses. And there is a lot of buzzwords in it. But I think basically, I mean, it doesn't make sense to run through that process step by step. So you start with ideation that is a bit like your scenario planning. I mean, you just come up with a lot of ideas. The more ideas, the better. You brainstorm and all the ideas are great. And then you build prototypes. This is how the Arduino was invented. The team around Massimo Banzi, a designer and technologist who was at that point teaching at the Ivrea School of Design. It's a great design school in northwestern Italy. So he was seeing how difficult it was to have these mock-ups, these prototypes that people could play with, done in interactive technology. And so he and his colleagues built this very simple board with which you could basically build any kind of interactive design. And that is the kind of the birth of the Arduino. I think that was in 2005, if I'm not totally mistaken. And I mean, Arduino has become to this date the standard. I mean, you know that from our physical computing classes, this is exactly the technology that you use. So the mock-up leads then to user testing. This is what you invite your friends or colleagues and then try to break the thing. I mean, so they're like, how stupid can people be in using that? And also you ask people if they enjoy using your product. And then you build the first prototype. A prototype is nothing that can be produced in large quantities. A prototype is something where you can make like maybe a couple to maybe a few dozen. So this is the prototype. The prototype is usually still soldered by hand or kind of assembled by hand. You can use rapid prototyping, like 3D printing for that, but you wouldn't 3D print mass-produced products. That takes far too long, as you know. I mean, using a 3D printer, that takes hours to build something. And so that's the prototype phase. With the prototype, you go into user testing again. And so this iteration of prototyping and user testing is called the lean startup process. So you build a minimum viable product. That is the product that works, but is kind of stripped bare. And you try it out in what's called the beta version. The alpha version is you only you and skilled people can use. The beta version is like everyone can use, but only people who should be introduced to it. So it's not for shelves where people just open the box and start playing with it. It is for people who know what they do. They are invited for a beta test or so. So and with the MVP, this lean startup thinking, comes this idea of permanent beta, that your product stays at that stage. And that makes so many products so annoying because they are never mature. They always break. And companies always learn by exposing their users to their mistakes. And that is certainly true for everything in the world of Microsoft and Android, but it is even true for Apple. If you buy a new Apple device when it comes out, it has usually a lot of bugs. I mean, if the new iOS version comes out and you update, it's usually like 6 hours later the first patch comes. And what companies do in this phase is they measure very precisely what people do and in particular where people fail. So if you have an app, for example, you look if people actually are using the app in the way you intended. And if not, you try to fix that in your user design. And the same And of course, in the technical side, if the app just crashes, I mean, then you analyze why it crashes. But the soft things are much better. So this measuring also works best if you have variants of your product. So you think of different user interfaces that you put out to different groups of users at the same time. That is called A/B testing. So you have the main version that is stable and you think that was quite good, and then you try out an alternative version that's a bit different, like what you envision, what you have learned through measuring, and you think that that might be better, and you try it out with maybe like 10 to 20% of your users, and then measure if it actually performs better than the version that that was previously out. And if that is the case, you change. And this is exactly, by the way, how Google, for example, optimizes their search algorithm, permanently measures and many, many alternative versions of the current kind of the current search algorithms are in place. Yeah, and often enough, you find out that your product was actually good for something totally different than you thought, and then you pivot. Pivot means that you change the focus of your company, and that happens really a lot. You could tell hours of stories about pivoting companies. My own company pivoted it a lot. I mean, starting as this kind of market research company, because that was my background, doing media and market research, and then we became kind of this mobile sensor company that would do measuring people's behavior with smartphone sensors, and then finally it became a blockchain company because that was then the next stage. I mean, using the data that we had kind of to do blockchainy things with it. So that was like three pivots that my company had before I left. So, and then now going into the creative part of it, I mean, the speculative design. Speculative design is not so much for startups. I mean, if you are a startup founder, you should have that in your brain yourself, but for big corporations. So, big corporations or governments, I mean, have difficulties in making it tangible how change looks. So, and if you have your scenario planning, you might actually ask, I mean, how do the things look? And you need some kind of prototyping, some kind of visualization. So I give you a nice example. We will look into this example at a later time when we talk about time. So this is the view from the hills of Greenwich in London towards the Isle of Dogs. So the Isle of Dogs is where in the 19th century, in particular, but probably earlier already in the 19th century, and basically until the time when I was a child, and I remember that vaguely, the Docklands were kind of an industrial space. I mean, it was where ships would moor. If you think of Abu Dhabi, that's the MENA. The MENA was a big port until Jebel Ali at the border between Dubai and Abu Dhabi was built, and that is now the port, and the MENA area is no longer the main port. And in London, that happened the same. And so around 1970, it looked like that. You would look down to this kind of Naval Academy, the Royal Navy Academy, or whatever that building is. It's a beautiful view, really. I totally enjoy it. It's one of my favorite spots in London. And you have this vast expanse of empty, given-up industrial space here. And in 1980, the conservative government of Margaret Thatcher decided that that was actually quite a waste and it should be turned into real estate. And it was very controversial at the time. It's very interesting to read through that. I mean, thinking of the cities here in the Gulf, it's the same time in which most of the cities in the Gulf, I mean, like Dubai and then Abu Dhabi, started to turn into big headquarter cities with millions of people. So it's the same happens here in good old London. And if you look, that's 50 years later, that's 2020, you see how much it has changed. This is Canary Wharf. This is how the area is now called on the Isle of Dog. That's basically all these shiny financial services palaces that have been built. So, and how would you come up with how that will look like? And I just have this super funny television show. I think it's from the from around 1990 or so or earlier, where Jules Holland, who has this show called Later, uses this kind of speculative design, having these kind of paper boxes that paper models that he would just put in and would show how you could turn this view into how it will look like in the future. I think of building a model, a scale model, that's a different way. Could of course also use Photoshop, but that's not as funny. So there's one book, I have that in the reading. You read it. It is really, although it is it's like 10 years old, it is the leading thing that was ever written about speculative design. Anthony Dunn and Fiona Raby, you could say, are the people who really defined the field. At that time, they were working at the Royal College of Art in London. They have now moved to New York and teach at the New School. So Dunn and Raby, I mean, if you look on YouTube, for example, on their talks, or just read what's in the book, I mean, you get an idea how it works, basically. It's really at the edge of design and art. So feel free to read it all and not only the assigned reading. Yeah, but just staying in London, I'm just thinking of how do you come up with design? I mean, sometimes you just stumble upon really weird things like this DNA nudge. It's this idea of DNA-based recommendations. So, you know, your health and your genome and so on. And you can start thinking of a future building on that. If you think of everyone has that and everyone has their wristband tracking their behavior or so, it becomes much harder to lead an unhealthy life because you actually have to be, I mean, you have to take responsibility suddenly. You see that it is not good for you. And there have been interesting studies in companies like Unilever did a nice study with their employees giving out smartwatches like Fitbit and say, well, you can have this watch for a year. We don't track you, but just do whatever you like with it. And the people who receive these watches were then like every month or so or every 3 months checked by a doctor, and then after the year, and then I think again after 2 years or so, and they all were so much healthier. So kind of this quantified self, this feedback of your own behavior, of your own body, into this visibility really changes you, and that's this nudging, I mean, pushing you softly into the righteous life. And you could, of course, come up with a kind of almost Soviet-style future of collectivism where everyone is their neighbor's keeper. So instead of just the employees kind of working together, kind of going running and so kind of encouraging each other to stay healthy, you would have that really on a very low level that everyone, like on the bucolic village, when everyone looks like, oh, did he actually hold hand with her? They are not married, you know, and she, I think she was the fiancée by someone. That's really bad. You know, this kind of vigilance on each other that you have in a village life or in a big family or so, then you kind of expand that on the level of the whole globe. And by that, do the big task. Instead of having an authoritarian government that tells you have to recycle, you have to save energy, instead of that, having it bottom up. Having people kind of becoming their neighbors, keepers, and watchers and enforce the righteous behavior on the very low level. So, this is a scenario that I've envisioned. It seems very dominant and very plausible thing if you see a shop like that. It's also always fun to look back into the past. So, if you think of Paul Sappho, looking back double the time into the past than you want to look into the future, it's even more fun to look what the future was kind of envisioned in that past. So this book is a bit older than I am. It's, I think, from 1968 or 69, the German book on technology, and it envisions the here clearly the future of urbanism. And on the first, I mean, you see what did they get right? I mean, clearly, I mean, that could be a Sheikh Zayed highway. Sheikh Zayed Road here in Dubai. I mean, it's exactly how that looks. And maybe instead of the red ball, you have the Museum of the Future. So, I mean, that is very clearly the design in which cities on the Gulf often are built. And it's no surprise. I mean, of course, people didn't come up with these ideas out of thin air. I mean, at that time, the foundations for the development here in the Gulf were laid. So people were thinking of how to build cities like that already. We discussed that with the model of Bell Geddes for General Motors, the Futurama. So you see, like 50 years after Futurama, that's still the future that people have in mind. Much more important to look what the scenario got right is to ask what did they get wrong, because that's the things in the Paul Sappho way from which you learn. And I mean, clearly what they got wrong is there is no way of self-driving cars like that anywhere close. I mean, we were hoping that like 10 years ago there was a huge craze of self-driving cars, but now it seems not really at hands. And second, I mean, not even in the middle of the night is SZR, the Sheikh Zayed Road, ever that empty. So usually you have congestion. And I mean, no self-driving car will resolve that, because I mean, it's still individual traffic. I mean, if you think of the metro maybe going at the side of this, like the metro in Dubai, the metro is also very full, but it doesn't matter so much. I mean, you can let it run more often, or you can try to get longer trains. But the car traffic and individual cars will always lead to congestion. And that is clearly something that's totally wrong in that scenario. So what did people get wrong? That is what you have to focus on. Yeah, let's stay with car traffic. So this is from another book that I have, that is from 1980, I think. That is a self-driving passenger car, like a van. And I mean, that was actually a kind of design fiction that was shown on the transportation trade fair in Europe. And it's this design that we see. Yeah, 40 years later, this design has practically hardly changed. I mean, if you compare these two designs, it's almost the same. So this is by the very fancy speculative design company IDEO. So IDEO is always also a good place to look for buzzy things and shiny objects, but also, I mean, many of their things are fun. So this is kind of the idea that IDEO comes up with, the office on wheels, work on wheels. And yeah, this is the office of the future. So you drive with your office on wheels, you drive into these big warehouses, and then you can have meetings. Or actually, I don't know, why would you actually drive there? I mean, why not just park your car on the side of the road and work there? This seems much more plausible than these weird warehouses. But I mean, so I think you already see that there are some flaws in this idea, and that I think will be very far out. However, I mean, if we ever get these self-driving cars, I mean, of course, it's very likely that people will work in their cars. And if you think of COVID and future pandemics, I mean, having your own confined space that is not tied to a big office building, but it's a bit more versatile, also makes sense. So it's very hard for people to work in their home all the time. I mean, that is really cruel. I mean, in particular, if you have a family. But if you have this kind of escape room, things become more easy. And why not use the second room that almost all people in the West, at least, and in rich countries have, which is the car, which is basically like a second small house, like a shed. It's just not very comfortable to sit in it. So there is something to see here that actually builds for a nice future. And this is, come up with these stories on your own. Here, by the way, is another one. And this is an actual company. So this is not design fiction. This is a prototype. So this car rolls around. You see the LiDAR and radar and ultrasonic sensors all around the roof. It's always what you see in self-driving cars is these sensors that scan. A self-driving car, of course, has to know its environment and make decisions. The AI in it has to make decisions. So this is the company Zoox, and Zoox was acquired by Amazon in 2020 for $1.2 billion. Which shows you again that there is money to be earned in the startup field. So this is Zoox, a company in which Amazon believes, coming up with this prototype. I mean, let's see what comes out of it. Well, this is Waymo. There's another prototype. It's a bit further advanced, I would say. I've seen the Waymo cars driving around in the Bay Area, also previous versions that looked a bit more like normal cars. So Waymo is the self-driving car company owned by the Alphabet, which is Google. So you see here, I mean, Google has its largest. I think the largest center out of the US in Munich, where I come from. So this is at the Deutsche Museum in Munich, at the where the halls where the vehicles are, so transportation technology. And you see it is in the museum already. You see the LiDAR on this hood, this dome on the roof, and the design of that is really interesting. It's kind of timid. I won't hurt you. It's very safe. And it's very small. It's only basically suitable for one, maybe two people. Yeah, and then, I mean, sometimes, I mean, design, I mean, so my plea here is please think outside of your local bias. So this is also IDEO. So they have this great design fiction for vertical farming. So vertical farming, I mean, where you have flower pots in rooms. And I think there is great potential for that. I mean, that is such a great thing to have fresh produce or so. But I don't need design fiction for that. I just go to Yas Island, to the Carrefour in Yas Mall, and see it. So this is long reality. In the UAE, we have vertical farming in many places, and you get your fresh lettuce directly picked. It's always fresh and it's free of pesticides and it's perfectly watered and also. So I mean here, so you see that before doing design fiction, better Google a bit if the thing that you are envisioning actually exists in reality. Well, just a few more for inspiration. So this is from a children's book. I think I showed other examples of space elevators also in the previous lectures. So this is a this also is a, I think 1978 is this book. This is kind of the Apple Watch. I think, I mean, of course, we don't have these LED, these red LED designs. We have much fancier displays now. But on the other hand, I mean, thinking of a watch that is very versatile and has all kinds of functionality, has a smartphone built in it or so, I think this is a pretty nice example. So again, look at what they got wrong. Clearly, the antenna, we don't have that. There's no antenna visible in the Apple Watch. The buttons, we don't need that. We have touch screen, although it's a bit clumsy, but I mean still. And the display, of course, we have the beautiful sapphire display with the retina screen, this OLED or whatever that is in high resolution, is so beautiful. We don't need these LEDs. So I mean these are things that are clearly wrong. So and think of why they got it wrong, because they got stuck into technology that was available at that time. But if you look ahead like 10 years, look back 20 years, what was available 20 years ago, if you think of 10 years in advance, Paul Sappho, and think of how much technology has advanced in the last 20 years. For example, smartphones started becoming a thing. The iPhone was invented, YouTube, the internet became broadband, and so on. So there's many things that that have changed. That is a bit like the interior of one of your smart cars. Clearly, that is a kind of a suburban setup. It's a bit like the villas in the suburbs of Abu Dhabi, what you see here, but a bit more green, but hard to tell. The screen telephone is one of my favorites, down to the right corner here. That is clearly not how that looks. That's, again, not ridiculing it, but I'm just thinking of what did they got wrong? What did they get wrong? I mean, that is just how screen phones at that time would look like. There have been prototypes already produced at that time. It was already in the kind of in the making, and people learned that it was not so great after all. So that. No one knew that the smartphone with this pocketbook size and easy touch screen would be the solution for that. And on the other hand, I mean, they have big screens on the wall. I mean, so they know that it will not be these vacuum tubes that you will, like old school television. The I would say training suit that the guy wears, the very comfortable or so. I mean, this is what people in the suburb really wear these days. I mean, just go into any at least Western suburb. This is how people walk around. I would say the big computer with the radar and other things and the cocktail serving robot are again, I mean, wrong for different reasons. I mean, the computer just, I mean, we don't need these specialized computer screens. We have just one screen and it becomes more and more one. That will just be some variation of iPhone or iPad, or likewise on the Android side. Robots like that we have, like the Roomba, that vacuums the house. I mean, I find that very convenient. I mean, the houses in particular in the Emirates have very flat floors, of most usually stone or tile. It's perfect for the Roomba to clean it. So we have that. It's just not so practical to think of the robot coming around with drinks. This is really something that I think even in the far future, people will still be comfortable walking into the kitchen and getting the drink themselves. That's my guess. This is a very nice piece of design fiction that I also saw in an exhibition on the Anthropocene. So kind of thinking of, I mean, you know, the production of meat, in particular beef, in terms of greenhouse gases and climate change is worse, actually, than driving cars. Driving cars has kind of flattened and cars become more and more efficient. So it is now really keeping animals that is the main driver for climate change, among others, of course. I mean, like heating your houses or having AC or so. I mean, and ships, so there's a lot of, but it's one that could be easily be changed. I mean, just going vegan, for example. However, if you think of alternative protein sources that replace meat, like Beyond Beef or the Impossible Beef, or there's many others, you realize that that you can do different things with it. Like, for example, there is these protein structures. If you really try to have GMO like meat, they are not so good in making a steak or something like that from that. And here's the design fiction: why not knit it and have kind of a knit structure? And I mean, although I wonder if we will see knit beef patties of alternative meat, I can imagine that after people get used to these alternative protein sources, these alternative kind of meat surrogates, these vegan meats, that people start thinking, well, actually, we can do other things with it. It doesn't need to resemble one-on-one meat because we can do all kinds of things with it. And then be very creative in this kind of the molecular cuisine style. Molecular cuisine is a great source, if you think of design fiction, for food to get inspiration. Yeah, and then the business model. I mean, that's also interesting to envision a world where drugs, among the kind of things, if you think of the design fiction for food, drugs become widely available. I mean, this, running a few years back, I went running in Los Angeles and I found this abandoned package of official marijuana. Yeah, so you just go. When that was legalized in California, I remember going to the going to a conference on big data, and by checking in the hotel, the concierge of the check-in person said, "And by the way, this is Dr. Smith, and he writes you the prescription for your recreational marijuana." So it was already built into the service of the hotel. Not that I'm so fond of that in particular, but I mean, it is an interesting thing. If you think of things change, think of the next wave that has already started in the UK, experimenting with psychedelic medications. So there is an interesting future ahead. I mean, don't be too much discouraged that, for example, in the UAE or maybe in Singapore and in other places, also in most places in Europe, still any kind of recreational drugs are pushed. I mean, still into criminality. That might change. That might change. And also, it's interesting to think of places where it might easily change or places where it might resist, and think of the tensions that that will build. Because things like drug cartels or so, I mean, get really under pressure if suddenly you can buy your drugs in the drugstore instead of a drug dealer. Yeah, to conclude, just throwing a few more of these frameworks at you. So this is from a book, I think Teaching Strategic Foresight or something like that. That's on readings. Here is why foresight. That's actually it's not bad. It's not bad. It's just very corporate. This is another way of getting together a nice scenario, a nice design future, design thinking, speculative idea. So you start. As I say, try to be not biased, try to be diverse, try to be post-colonial in your thinking. Don't be focused on one market alone, because other people might already have the idea that you think is so original. And then think of the field of the questions. That's a bit like what issues to address. And of course, your mental bias. I mean, think of what you like and what you don't like and push that away. I mean, you might just think of things that you really hate or that you think that are immoral, and still it's worthwhile thinking them through, because they might not, I mean, the world doesn't care what you think or not. And it always makes a good story also if things are really bad, because that creates suspense. Just thinking. And so on. I mean, you collect information. That is, I think, really this is the most important part, is analysis. In all these things, I mean, just look thoroughly. Just don't stay on Wikipedia. That's maybe your first point of reference, but then go deep. Really think of who might have done things like that, and use the resources that in academia you have, like JSTOR and the library and things like that, where you can do really esoteric things, or the archive where you get all these pre-published papers. That's the great resources to know what is possible, and then come up with as many scenarios as possible, so that you have a range of things that you can condense. What I find nice here is acting. Try to think of how to actually implement the changes. I mean, how would an organization work? How would you do it? I mean, in a real way. That's the last point, with this acting. So. And here, so I think from the same paper, start with your scenario planning, so which delivers you kind of the scaffolding of a good story. That's how you can think of your scenario, the elements of a good story. Plausible drama, so to say. So your story, I mean, although, I mean, maybe the story, for example, of vertical farming or alternative meat or so, doesn't seem so dramatic, but come up with stories that sound dramatic. Think of a person living in that future and getting some kind of in pressure, someone who messes things up or who has some kind of personal ailment that prevents him from them from succeeding and whatever. Be personal with that. I mean, it should always be something that you could think of being with yourself or with people you know very well, so that it is plausible. And be cohesive, so that your plot doesn't fall apart. I mean, it really should create a sound a story that that is not inconsistent. And in particular, cheap science fiction like this B-movies from the late 70s, early 80s or so often are kind of, I say, oh God, didn't they, would it have been so expensive to have someone look over that and say, well, actually, that doesn't make any sense. And then, I mean, everything has to happen at some point and has reason to be happening. So you have to invent the history of your future. And you can't change, I mean, of course you can think of alternative histories. You could just think of what if Hitler won the war, or what if the UK would have stayed in colonial power in the Gulf. I mean, that is alternative histories. But I mean, if you want to be forward-looking, I mean, of course you don't change these things. You just change you just envision what happens in the future, and for that you need, I mean, if you think of being a future in 5 years, you need to fill these 5 years in a plausible way. That's the facts, names, dates that happen there. And it, of course, everything that happens there should be plausible. I mean, it has to not be totally contradictory, and everything that happens has effects. So I mean, if things just go on, I mean, you can mention that, but that, of course, has no impact on the future that you describe, because your future that you describe is different. And now comes, of course, the thing that makes things kind of the beef of your story, the fascinating thing, which is that there is conflict, there is things that are. In tension with each other, that there is bad things that happen, and unintended consequences on the good and the bad. The unintended consequences is actually the most interesting thing. You think of an invention that seems really bad, and then in the end it turns out to be really good or something like that. That is actually more fun than the other way around. The other way around is very, I mean, you think of someone invents the car, and then of course that's also the tank that goes to war, or someone invents the rocket, and which is nice for fireworks, but then of course it's also nice to carry bombs on other cities or so. This is kind of straightforward. Everyone knows the technology is that way, but the other way around is also fun. I mean, think of things that are invented kind of in bad faith and then turn out to be beneficial, because that makes your story fun to read or to watch. And then finally, I mean, what I really like as an imperative is it's always the best to envision the future by thinking of what would organized crime do. So this is many of the great science fiction authors work that way, that they look at a certain time and think, how would that look like for the mob? So a lot of, for example, William Gibson's writing in Neuromancer, but in the books that followed that, comes from his fascination of Victorian London organized crime gangs. So you can learn how organized crime works. I mean, look, this watch shows about that, like The Sopranos or so. That's fun. And think of how would that in the future be. Or Google things like what the drug cartels in Latin America, how very creative they are in using top technology to getting their things across borders and distribute their product, and then recollect the money back to their home and not being cracked down by tax authorities and all these things. So organized crime is always interesting to see how it operates. Or think of a more recent case that's super interesting to look at. It's Silk Road. Silk Road that was kind of this Amazon for drugs and weapons and prostitution or so. I mean, really, you can't imagine how bad it was. Just look at that. So Silk Road and think of Bitcoin kind of as the complement which you would pay, and think of a Silk Road like future. So this is what I want to give you at hand, these two lectures in your toolbox for corporate thinking, of coming up with business ideas, of having your own startup pitch, or inventing kind of the speculative design future. In the next lecture, we will look into more intellectual ways of defining the future by writing manifestos and making proper art.